It didn't come, so the video will be sent to her.
Okay, please, I need to confirm if the recording has
It's
started.
recording. It has
It's
started.
recording.
Only
Okay,
if
okay.
to make sure it's on the cloud.
Yeah, to the cloud, yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Go
Okay,
ahead.
so let me just go back. I won't read all those stuff again, please. Okay. Let me just. Okay. So I talked about how evolution and innovation has brought us to where we are today, right from the day where we have the incandescent light bulbs to the compact fluorescent lamp, up to the point where we have the LED lamp lights that we have today, which is more like the most energy efficient lighting technology we have in the market today. And I talked about the goal of energy efficiency program is to maximize productivity of energy, keeping waste as low as possible. And I also try to explain what energy efficiency is for businesses. So in that regard, I say that a productive work, in other words, in the practice of, sorry, energy efficiency refers to the efficient conversion and use of energy, and is a measure of productivity provided per unit of energy consumed. So if you consume 1 unit of energy, what is the productive value? That's what that is. Okay. I don't want to go through all of these texts. Let me just proceed. Then for countries to help their citizens understand energy efficiency better, they introduced the labeling, energy labeling. So fortunately, we have one in Nigeria, through the effort of GIZ and some government MDAs. So they came up with this, but it's just for the air conditioning system, not for audio appliances. So if you look at the second image, you're going to see the Nigerian energy level. Okay. And I said that the designation from trusted agency means that the appliance exceed minimum energy performance standard, usually by a significant amount. Then products without these labels are most likely inefficient in energy consumption. Then I try to explain the flow of energy in power generation in the Nigerian context. Okay, you started with 100% gas, 100% energy in gas. Then you convert that gas through a boiler to convert it to thermal energy. You use that thermal energy to drive a turbine, which is a mechanical energy, and you use that mechanical energy to drive alternating electric generator. Then you have electricity. So at the point you're coming now, you have 32% of electricity. You started with 100%. Now you have 32. The electricity has to pass through transmission and distribution network, and there are losses along the line. As it passes through all of this, by the time it gets to your house, you have just 17% of the electricity. You started with 100%, now you have 17%. So what is the ratio? 1 to 4.9, okay? So what this means that if you save 1 unit of electricity on your house, in your house, or on the demand side, you're actually saving 4.9 units in the form of fuel or gas, and the infrastructure that was used to deliver that electricity to you. And the funny thing is that you're not just paying for 1 unit of electricity, the cost of that 1 unit of electricity includes the cost of all of those wasted electricity that was that occur along the line to deliver that 1 unit to you. And that's why it's very, very important we take energy efficiency seriously. If we do that, we'll be able to reduce the amount of electricity that we need to produce, or rather we can service more people with the amount of electricity that we have, while also improving reducing the emission of greenhouse gases. So what I just explained in the previous slide is also the same thing that is happening here. I just put it in another format. So this is energy efficiency potential in Nigeria. I think yesterday somebody was, we had a slight discussion about government involvement in energy efficiency and all of that in terms of regulation, policies and all of that. So here I provide a snapshot about how far we've gone in terms of government's efforts to stimulate the energy efficiency market in Nigeria. And mind you, when we're talking about energy efficiency, you can't take away energy audits from there. Okay? It is through energy audit to now be able to identify energy efficiency measures that can be implemented. So they go hand in hand. So the potential of energy efficiency in Nigeria, in Nigerian industry, is huge. According to UNIDO, United Nations Industrial Development Organization, between 25-40% in developing countries, that's between 25-40% of energy savings can be achieved in developing countries. Okay, now they just went ahead to further state how that can be achieved. I'll just go ahead. you can read up all of this. We don't have much time. We have a lot to cover. So these are the policies of government, you know, to support and promote energy efficiency in Nigeria. I talked about National Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency Policy yesterday, and also mentioned National Energy Efficiency Action Plan. Then I also talked about the Paris Agreement. Now, the National Determined Contribution is a contribution that Nigeria made to that Paris Agreement. So we also have the National Industrial Policy. This is an overview of the National Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency Policy. It was approved by Federal Executive Council in 2015. And then we can read up some of these things. So here we begin. So what are the causes of inefficiency? What actually causes inefficiency in the system? Okay, because if you don't know what causes inefficiency, it might be very difficult for you to actually find a cure. If you don't know what causes a sickness, it might be hard for you to actually find a cure for it. So let's actually understand what causes inefficiency. There are two primary causes of inefficiency. One is technical loss, and the other one is human behavior. Okay, so in trying to understand energy efficiency, there's what we call energy balance. Okay, input must equals output. That's energy balance. If input is not equals output, something is happening along the line. Okay, so energy input is equals to energy used for useful purposes plus energy used that we are wasted plus the losses. I take that again. Energy input is equals to energy used for useful purposes or productive purposes plus energy used that we are wasted, then plus losses. So if you leave your light surrounding light bulb on during the day, it's wasting because the sun is enough to provide illuminations. You don't need to use artificial technology to provide that. Okay, so it's being wasted. So our job is to identify the energy use that we are wasted and the losses, not energy use that we are useful. So your job as an energy auditor or an energy manager or an energy expert is to x-ray the facility, x-ray the system, x-ray the equipment, x-ray the machine, okay, to determine where energies are wasted. Okay, and also determine the losses. Now, these losses, you cannot stop losses entirely. Okay, now the reason why you have those losses is just to overcome frictional forces, not just frictional forces, resistance forces actually, of which frictional force is one of the resistance force. Okay, so you cannot overcome it entirely, but you should be able to reduce it to the barest minimum. Okay, such that more of the energy that goes into the system are being used for useful purposes. Then energy used that we are wasted actually can be stopped. It can reduce that to zero, okay? Most of the factors of this energy that we are used that are wasted are human behavior, okay? And if you're able to control human behavior, if you're able to educate people, make them understand that, look, you don't operate this equipment this way, this is what you should do and everything, you can actually reduce those wastages, zero, okay? Even though it might look impossible, but it is possible. Then I've talked about the losses, okay? So why you want to do all of this, you must define your boundary. It's very important. If you want to do energy balance, you must create a boundary. So if you're looking at your own house, maybe the energy input has to be from your meter. So you look at your meter, what is going into your meter? They have to trace it down to your fridge, to your TV, to your fan, to your lighting point and everything, and make sure that the energy consumption of all of these things put together is equal to the energy that entered your house, okay? Now, in doing that, you also have to account for the losses, okay? If your light bulb is consuming this, what could be the losses between the meter through the wires to my light bulb and all of that? So it must equal. That's the whole essence of an energy audit. Just like if you're doing account or financial audit, inflow should equal outflow. That's just it. And that's the name energy audit. So in the first day, I talked about coefficient of efficiency. So this is how you measure efficiency. If you're not speaking, please, could you just turn off your mute your mic? Uche, is that coming from you? Okay, good. So this is how you measure the efficiency level of any system, okay? So now, how you determine that is energy input is equal to useful energy plus losses. The same thing I talked about in the previous slide. So efficiency is equal to useful energy over energy input. It's a no-brainer. This is just the normal formula for efficiency in any system, okay? Useful output over input, okay? So, and I did mention that you must define your system boundary. You have to do this. So now how to look at industrial process, energy efficiency in industrial applications. So first of all, let us start from the fuel combustion, because in most cases, that's your primary source of energy, input. Primary source of energy input this time is usually from fuel, okay? So a lot of industries use gas in their boiler and so many other industrial processes. So it's not just about electricity, okay? So in many cases, your primary, even when you're generating electricity, in many cases, Nigeria is a typical example, your primary feedstock is fuel, and it's, you have to combust that fuel. So let us start from fuel combustion. Okay, so combustion is simply a chemical process of converting hydrocarbon fuel to thermal or heat energy. That's just a simple definition of what the combustion is. And below, you're going to see a formula. It's a chemical process, okay? If you combine hydrocarbon with oxygen and heat, okay, you just have flame, fire. It's science, okay? So when that happens, what you actually want, in many cases, what you actually want out of that chemical process is the heat. So what do you do with the heat, okay? So for boiler, you want to transfer that heat to water and raise the temperature and perhaps to convert it to steam, okay? So what is the purpose of you combusting that fuel, okay? So it must not just be heat. There could be other reasons why you want to do that, but in most cases, you want the heat. So let us look at combustion efficiency. Okay, you're going to see different kinds of combustion. Okay, you have complete combustion and you have incomplete combustion. Now, the number four image there represents a complete combustion. And as it's moved towards the left side, you now begin to have incomplete combustion. So let's talk about complete combustion. Now, complete combustion has blue flame, no residue, high temperature. I mean, you convert a lot of the chemicals into heat because that's what you want. You want the heat to do your cooking, to warm your house, whatever it is, you want the heat. So of course, high efficiency. Then when you have an incomplete combustion, you begin to have that yellow and orange flame, okay? Then you begin to have black residue, smoke. You begin to have low temperature. You begin to have energy. That is, then you have energy that are wasted because the fuel was not completely combusted. It was not completely burnt, okay? So then, because it's not completely burnt, you have some toxic gases, such as the carbon monoxide, that is the CO. If you have a complete combustion, what you're going to have is CO2. Let me take you back. So you see that you're going to have CO2 plus water vapor plus heat. That H2O is water, but not as a liquid form. It's water vapor, okay? It's coming out as a steam, okay? So when you have incomplete combustion, it's highly inefficient. So our goal is to make sure that you are able to achieve complete combustion. That's our goal, okay? And that's why you're cooking with your gas, you're able to cook faster, but if someone is cooking with firewood, I mean, in as much as you're seeing the high flame, but it's not actually cooking the food faster, okay? So let's just proceed. So what is complete combustion? We talked about the characteristics of complete combustion. To ensure complete combustion of the fuel used, combustion chambers are supplied with excess air. Excess air increases the amount of oxygen to the combustion and then the combustion of the fuel, okay? Remember I said it's a chemical process. You have to add oxygen. Now the reason you're adding air is because air contains oxygen. About 21% of air is oxygen, while about 70 something percent is nitrogen, but you can't separate both of them. So you have to add air, okay, to add, as a way of adding oxygen to achieve a complete combustion. And because you don't know the exact amount of air that you have to add, it is advised that you add excess air, but not too much of excess air, okay? So that's why the term excess air is coming there. So when a fuel and oxygen from the air are in perfect balance, the combustion is said to be st- stoichiometric. Okay, this, no, forget about the big grammar. This is what it means. Chemical formula, chemical equation that you can see is what it means. Okay, when the oxygen and the hydrocarbon are in perfect balance, you have what that big grammar that's speaking there is stoichiometric system. So the combustion efficiency increases with increased excess air until the heat loss in the excess air is larger than the heat provided by more efficient combustion. So if you keep adding air, it will get to a point where you begin to have losses in, I mean, the temperature of your stack gas. When I say stack gas, I mean the smoke from the combustion process. If you look at if you measure the temperature of the process, you find out the temperature will begin to rise. Okay, at that point, your SSA is now becoming too much. Okay. So how do we know when we have gotten to that point of sufficient excess air? So don't over induce or over introduce the excess air. Now there is a chart here. Now excess air is achieved. Now excess air to achieve the highest possible efficiency for common fuel. Okay, this is just the percentage excess air that you should add. So if you're burning natural gas, SSA should be between 5 to 10%. If you go beyond 10%, above 10%, then your efficiency begins to drop. Look at that chart. You're going to see the red line. It's indicating the combustion efficiency. Okay, and at the highest efficiency is, for you to achieve the highest efficiency, it is advised that the SSA should be between 5 to 10% for natural gas, then for fuel oil and for coal. For coal, you have SSA should be between 5 to 60%. Okay. So if you don't add, if you add less air, if you don't have enough of the air, you find out that your efficiency will begin to drop. If you add too much of the SSA, your efficiency also begins to drop. So it's good that you know your best efficiency point, your combustion process. So how do you determine that? There's a tool that you can use to be able to do that. So insert the electronic probe into the stack, into stack to measure. Now the stack is the exhaust pipe, pipe actually. Okay, take this device and put it there. Okay, and you measure the O2 level, that is oxygen level. Okay, the oxygen level should tell you, remember I told you for natural gas, your SSA should not be more than 10%. Okay, so you, using that electronic probe, you should be able to tell the level of percentage of oxygen in that your excess air, in your stack gas, Okay. So your stack temperature rise above combustion, Okay, your stack temperature rises above the combustion air inlet temperature, okay? So sometimes you might preheat your inlet air. We'll come to that. I will explain this when we get to that. So other possible measurements when you're looking at your stack gas, you're looking at CO. Remember I told you that if you have an incomplete combustion, you're going to have carbon monoxide. So you're looking at the CO in your stack gas to see. So if once you begin to see carbon monoxide, what does that say? That your fuel is not completely burned. So you have unburned fuel that have been sent out to the atmosphere. Okay, it tells you there is no that the fuel has not been completely burned. And once it is not completely burned, the heat that it should have been released to you is not released. So it has been wasted. Okay. So that is about combustion process. And from there, we look at boiler system. Remember, boiler has combustion chamber. Okay. So we'll take it step by step. So now this is a boiler system. Boiler are needed to generate steam. Steam and heat carriers for industrial processes. Now, in the whole of what we are going to be doing, we are going to be dealing a lot with heat. Most industrial processes are just basically addition of heat or subtraction of heat. So when you're taking out heat, you're cooling. If you're adding heat, you're heating. Okay. So how do you generate and deliver that heat, you know, across your industrial processes? Okay. So that's why you need boiler to generate steam. So steam and heat carriers. And you take that steam and you now use it to distribute heat. So it's more like you have an electricity system, electricity wires, okay? You have wires to transport your electricity to the point of your equipment. So steam does that for us in this case. So boiler systems have heat carriers, they have fuel, and they have heating surface and layout, they have pressures. Okay. We can read off some of these things. So there are basically two kinds of boilers. Okay, there could be other type, but basically you have two kinds of boilers. Okay, so you have the fire tube boilers and you have the water tube boilers. Okay, this is just a rough image of what they look like, but I will explain that in the next slide. So you have water tube boilers. So what this means that, as the name implies, water is passing through a tube. Okay, for those of us who have, who understand heat exchange, heat exchangers, or who have had one or two things to do with heat exchangers, you know that the most common type of heat exchanger is shell and tube, okay? So there is a tube, there is a shell. So if you look at the red section of the first image there, that red section can be regarded as a shell. Then the blue portion of it can be regarded as a tube, okay? So water tube boiler means that water is passing through the tube while you're heating the shell, okay? As the name implies, water tube boilers. Okay, so what I mean that hot gases flows around tubes that are filled with water, and the essence is to heat up that water. So tubes will be connected to a steam drum that will eventually distribute the steam. So large and high pressure, this is not very common in industry. The one that is more common is the image on the left, which is the fire tube boilers. So fire tube boilers is the reverse of the fire tube. So as the name also implied, fire tube, the heat from the fire is passing through the tube while water is passing through the shell. Okay, so why this is happening, the heat exchange between the water and the heat inside the tube. Okay, so this is a heat exchanger. So fire tube boilers hot gases flow through the tubes that are submerged in water. Tubes normally make multiple passes. You have to flow multiple times and keep absorbing the heat, okay? I mean, or in this case, it keeps dissipating the heat in the water. But in the other way, the water passes through the tube several times and keep absorbing the heat from the shell, okay? So it uses a relatively low pressure, and this is very common, you know, in the industry. So this is the conversion process. When you begin to heat water, okay, the temperature begins to rise until it gets to 100 degrees. Now at 100 degrees, I think that means the same thing as 212 degree Fahrenheit. So in our own Nigerian context, it's 100 degrees. At 100 degrees, you keep adding heat, but the water temperature is not rising. It uses that extra heat to change phase. I discussed this in the first class, in the first lecture. Yeah. So it uses that heat energy to change phase. So it turns from liquid to gas. So water in the form of gas is now steam, okay? So when you keep adding that heat to that steam, it keeps, it suddenly becomes superheated steam, okay? So that's the process. You add heat to the water, you get 100 degrees centigrade, it converts to steam. And that steam is now what you now push around your industrial processes, and then use the heat at the point where you need them. I'm trying to see if anyone is at the word general. Okay, someone says the computer is waiting. Oh. Just a moment, please, let me admit the people at the waiting room. Okay, I think I've admitted everyone. Sorry for those of you that were at the waiting room. Sorry, I didn't take notice of that. Okay, so let's proceed. Please, if you notice anyone at the waiting room, please, you can always just, or if any of your participants know that someone is at the waiting room, please drop a message at the chat. I can easily read from the chat. Okay, so we'll proceed. Okay, so now we need to know how to calculate heat flows, okay? When you're adding heat to water, you need to know how to calculate the amount of heat you need to add to water, okay, to raise it to a certain temperature. As when you don't want to heat that water to 100 degrees, you don't want steam. You just want the water to be at maybe 90 degrees centigrade, maybe from 10 degrees to 90 degrees. How do you determine the quantity of heat that you're going to add? Okay, or if it's, okay, now that's not going to air. So there are equations to be able to do that. And the beauty of what, of the certified energy auditor is that you don't need to cram these formulas. It's an open book. You can write them down and then use them in your calculations and all of that. But it's good you know them. At least you know the formulas to apply and know where to get the formulas. Okay, so that's the good thing. So the first equation that you're seeing there is for sensible heat only. Remember when I talked about sensible heat and latent heat, okay? Sensible heat are the ones you can feel. Latent heat is for changing of phase, okay? So it is, the Q means quantity of heat. The M there means the mass of the liquid, maybe the mass of water. It can also be the volumetric flow rate of the water. And either of them works well. So it's mass flow or volumetric flow rate. Then the Cp is the specific heat capacity of water. It's a constant. Then you have dT, which means change in temperature. From what temperature to what temperature are you heating your liquid or air, if it's the case of air? From what temperature to what temperature are you heating? So the first equation is for sensible heat. In other words, if you're heating up to 150 or 200 degrees centigrade, it's no longer sensible heat. Okay, it's now latent heat, sensible and latent heat. So that's where the next equation applies. Okay, so and the third equation is if you want to transfer heat through a surface, you're not heating water this time around. Okay, but maybe you're cooking in your kitchen, and somehow the heat is coming into your sitting room through the wall. Okay, so if you want to calculate the heat transfer from your kitchen to your sitting room through the wall. So that's where you apply the third equation, which is heat flow through surfaces. Okay, yeah. So now I define what those parameters mean. I'd say that Q is heat flow, M is mass flow rate, dT, temperature change, specific capacity, then delta H is change in enthalpy. Okay, then U is thermal conductivity of, now this is for the surface. The thermal conductivity of the surface, and A means the area of the surface. Now this is for the surface heat flow through a surface. So just a test question.
Hello.
Yeah, please. You have a question?
Yeah. Can you go back to the previous slide?
Okay.
That U there should not be thermal conductivity. That should be heat transfer coefficient. Except if you want to define thermal conductivity, then you have to divide that equation by delta X. Because if you are computing heat transfer by conduction, it should be K, which is thermal conductivity, times A.
What this is thermal conductivity?
K multiplied by A, then dT dx, which is temperature gradient. But if you are doing for convention, then that equation is correct. So U there is the heat transfer coefficient, which is convective heat transfer coefficient.
Okay. So I think both of them mean the same thing, except if I'm at lost here. We are saying heat transfer coefficient and thermal conductivity.
There are two different things. One is for conduction, one is for convention.
Heat transfer.
What you wrote there, that EU there, should be heat transfer coefficient, not thermal conductivity.
Okay.
If you want to make that thermal conductivity, then you have to divide that equation by delta X.
Okay, I will need to verify. What about resistivity? Because you know, you can ask us also change that to resistivity, but then it becomes an inverse. So when you're not talking about the surface, you cannot talk about the thermal resistivity of the surface.
Of course, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, but the way as this equation is now, that U should be heat transfer coefficient, not conductivity.
Okay.
You can move ahead. We'll check that.
Let's go ahead.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you for the interest. So now, just a test question. Heat, which when added or subtracted does not result in change of temperature, is called as what? You can unmute your mic and say. Just a test question.
It's latent heat.
Okay. I need more opinion. Okay, so heat, which when added or subtracted, does not result in a change of temperature, is called latent heat. You're very much correct. So let's take a sample question. How much heat is required to raise the temperature of water flowing at 100 kilograms per hour from 20 to 100 degrees centigrade? Okay, so specific heat of water here is 4.2. Okay, how much heat is required to raise the temperature of water flowing at 100 kilograms per hour from 20 to 100? So let me just present the solution here. So using the sensible heat formula, you have the MCP delta T in kilowatt. So the quantity of heat, which is Q, we know what the M is, okay? Which is 100 kilograms per hour. We are given the constant, which is the specific heat capacity of water. And then we know what the temperature difference is. From you want to raise that temperature from 20 to 100. So the difference is 80 degrees centigrade. So when you do the calculation, you're going to get at 3,600 kilojoule per hour, okay? But we want this answer in kilowatts, okay? Remember, kilojoule itself is a unit of energy. So that 3,600 kilojoule is energy, okay? So how do we convert it to electricity form in terms of kilowatt hour? So 1 kilowatt hour is equal to 3,600 kilojoule, okay? So if we now use that to convert our 3,600 kilojoule, we would have 9.33 kilowatt hour, okay? So we now further divide that with H, so H cancels out H, okay? And then you are now at 9.33 kilowatts. So that's how you use that equation, you know, to determine the quantity of heat amount of energy that you need to raise the temperature of the water flowing at 100 kilograms per hour. If you have any question, please do ask. Contributions is always welcome. Okay, so the next sample question is this. A gas-fired water heater heats water flowing at the rate of 5 liters per minute from 20 to 75, that is the temperature difference. If the gross calorific value of the gas is 4 times 10 raised to the power 7 joule per kilogram. Now this is the energy content per kilogram of the gas, okay? What is the rate of combustion of gas in gram per minute? Assume efficiency of water heater is 60%. Density of water is 1,000 kilogram per meter cube. Specific capacity of water, of course, is always constant, 4.2 kilojoule per kilogram per degree centigrade. Okay, this might look a bit complex, but it's not bad. At your own time, you can always take time to look at the solution, digest the question, understand it, and then review the solutions again. So I usually like to do my solution on the same page with the question, but this is quite different. So you're not seeing the question. So what we have here is 5 liters per minute, okay? That was given to us. The water was flowing at 5 liters per minute. That means the same thing as 5 kilograms per minute, okay? So quantity of heat transfer, using our heat transfer equation, okay? MCP dT, okay? At 60% efficiency. So if you put the value that we are given, 5 kilograms per minute times the specific heat capacity of water, times the temperature difference at 60% efficiency, okay? The quantity of heat that you're going to arrive at is 1,925 kilojoules per minute, okay? But the question is asking you, what is the rate of combustion of the gas in gram per meter? Someone's, if you're not speaking, can you please move to your mic? I don't know if that's so much about your eye. Can you please mute your mic if you're not speaking?
You can mute. You can mute. Click on the participant and mute everybody.
Okay. I'll just do that.
Sorry, before you...
Okay, okay. Sorry, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Yeah, please. Sorry for drawing you back. The first sample question you gave was not my slide.
Was not what? It's not on your. It's not in your slide, right?
Yes. The first
okay.
One.
Yes. 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 That's not a problem. At the end of this presentation, I will share this updated slide with everyone. Even up to last night, I still worked on this slide because I added some questions, some more sample questions, and I think I removed some things that I felt that they are not very necessary. Okay. So I'm going to share this updated slide with everybody at the end of the class. That's not a problem.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So like I said, the question was more specific. What is the rate of combustion of the gas in gram per minute? Okay, so our answer must have to be in gram per minute. Okay, and we are given the the calorific gross calorific value of the gas, okay, in joule per kilogram. So that's the energy content per kilogram of that gas. That's what that means. Now we've gotten our heat flow as 1,925 kilojoule per minute. So every minute, you have a heat flow of 1,925 kilojoule. That's what that means. Then what gas has 4 × 10⁻⁷ joule per kilogram. So rate of combustion would be, we have to divide our heat flow, okay, by that gas gross calorific value. Okay, that's what I did here. And when you do that, you have 0.048128 kilogram per minute, right? So when you now multiply that by 1,000, you have 48 gram per minute. Okay, it might look a little bit complex, but it's easy. Okay, it's easy. I will always advise that when you read questions, try to understand the question first before you attempt solve. So let us look at heat losses in boilers. So these are the same images I shared with you the other time. So we're going to look at the places where heat losses occur. Now you have heat in the gas. Remember that when you boil, look at the heat gases out at the top of the image. You see heat gases out. So those are the fluid gases. There are heat that have been sent out. Okay, we need to recover those heat. Okay, so that's heat waste. Okay, heat in moisture content of the fluid. Now that same fluid that you're seeing there has some water vapor. That water vapor contains it. That's why it is in water vapor. Otherwise, it would be in liquid form of water. So we also need to recover that heat in that water vapor, okay? And we are seeing the range of heat gain that we can get from them. I mean, the range of efficiency we can gain from these heat losses. So for these two that I just mentioned, you can get from 8 to 35% heat recovery from your stack gas, okay? So the factor is exit temperature, excess. So you have to look at the exit temperature. You have to begin to introduce some certain technologies to recover those heat from the exit temperature. So the next one is incomplete combustion. I explained this earlier. If you have an incomplete combustion, that means that the fuel that went into your combustion didn't release all the energy it has. So it just passes and then it goes out, okay? There's what's called blow down water, okay? We'll talk about it as we proceed with this in the steam section, we'll talk about the blowdown water. Someone is at the waiting room. Okay, I think I have to admit it. So another one is radiation from the boiler surfaces. Okay, the surfaces of the boiler, the walls of the boiler. Of course, through conduction, heat will now, you know, migrate to the outer surface, and radiation it will now dissipate into the surrounding environment. Then you have combustible ashes. You know, when you burn your fuel, your fossil fuel, sometimes you have combustible some fuel that some of the energy in the. So if you burn firewood, sometimes the ash that you throw will still have some fuel in it that can still be harnessed and then release the heat contents. So that's what that means. Then path load operation. We all know that when you're operating any equipment on a path load, you know, there's mostly always inefficiency induced in the process. Okay. So that's what, so these are the sources of heat loss. In the boiler, we are going to come to the steam. This is just when the boiler. The boiler is just part of the entire steam system. So we'll get to that. So energy saving opportunities in the boiler, okay? So installation of economizer, okay, this is what economizer look like. Economizer is using heat exchanger to trap the heat in the stack gas, okay? You kind of, you remember when I talked about shell and tube heat exchanger? It's that same technology that you use to collect the heat that is in the stack gas, okay? Stack the exit gas. You collect that heat, and what do you do with that heat? You can use it to preheat your boiler, I mean your boiler water, okay? Then you have combustion air preheat. This is what it means. In that same stack gas, you can collect the heat in the stack gas, but this time not water, you're collecting it as air. You're using air to strap the heat, and then you're sending it into your combustion chamber, you know, to improve your combustion efficiency. So combustion control, okay? You need to control your combustion in this regard. And these are part of the measures you can take. How much heat do you need? You need to tune down your boiler to produce just the exact amount of heat that you need. So you need to be able to control your boiler. Then blowdown optimization heat recovery. I'll get to a blowdown system. That's all called blowdown in a steam system. I will get to that. Then I will explain that more. So some of them might not be clear until I get to the next slide. But it's good you just become aware at this stage. Then installation or repair insulation. Of course, this is a no-brainer. You need to insulate your boiler system so that the heat losses through the walls and everything are minimized. Then load management, your requirement for heat. How do you make sure that you don't use heat unnecessarily? Okay, so if you optimize the use of your heat, then of course you optimize the fuel that will be needed to burn to generate those heats. The VSD, variable speed drive, it's sent as variable frequency drive or adjustable speed drive. They all mean the same thing. Then for fan, so you can install VSD for fan blowers and pump. Then boiler replacement. If your boiler is old, you might need to replace it, you know, for more efficient technology. Then general good housekeeping measures. So I already explained it. This is a way of recovering heat from your boiler, from the stack temperature, using water. So when you're using water to recover the heat and you're sending that water back into your feed water system, it's known as economizer. When you're using air to recover that heat and you're sending it into your combustion chamber, you know, to preheat the incoming air, it's known as the recuperator. So boiler checklist. Okay, I mean, if you want to look through the optimization of a boiler system, this is a checklist you just have to go through. So you look at you have to check of the maintenance. That's maintain efficient combustion, maintain good water treatment, then repair water and steam leaks. Of course, you can read up all of these things. Let me just move ahead. Now, this is steam system. Remember I talked about steam while I was talking about boiler. Now, boiler is part of the steam system. So boiler generates the steam, then the steam system is, the steam how to distribute it around the facility. So this is what a steam system looks like. In the steam system, you're still going to see boiler. So this is the boiler, okay? So boiler is used to generate steam. If you look here, you see the blue line that is coming in. This is the air that is coming in into it. So if you look here, you see air preheater. This what you're seeing here is the stack. Is the stack. So after combustion, the heat that is going out from this boiler, you use air to strap it and you send it back into the boiler. Here you see economizer. Okay, you use water to strap the heat first, then you send it into the feed water that is going into the boiler, just to make sure that no heat is lost. That's the essence. So when you now generate the steam, you have to, now steam comes at the pressure, okay? So once it's energized, it moves, okay? So it moves through the steam distribution system, then you have the heat exchangers into the various areas you need them for your industrial processes. Maybe you need this for drying, to dry some materials and all of that, you know? But it just goes around, just like you distribute your electricity within your building. The same way you distribute the heat within your building, you know, to the point where you need them for any industrial applications. So that's what the system is all about. Okay, so here you see something that is called steam trap. Okay, while this steam is moving, okay, of course there's a temperature drop. Remember, as it's leaving this boiler, it's leaving the form of steam. Steam is not visible. If you can see it, it's no longer steam. So it moves through this pipe, okay? As it's moving, the temperature begins to drop. So as the temperature drops, some of the steam returns back to water. So that's condensation. It returns back to water, okay? You need to remove that water. If you don't remove that water, it can damage your system. There's what we call water hammering, okay? It can damage your system. So water hammering, I will explain it this way. Imagine that a wind is moving with a high velocity and all of a sudden it picks up a stone and that stone lands on a glass, okay? Obviously, it's most likely going to shatter that glass, but the air itself will just slide over the glass and move out. But that stone will cause a noise and shatter that glass. That's what water hammering is. As the steam is moving and it picks up some water that has condensed into the steam process, it makes that kind of noise, you know, around the pipes. Okay, and it's not good, and it also affects the quality of the steam. So we need to remove the condensates in the steam system, and that's what steam trap does. You see steam trap here, you see steam trap, you see steam trap here, that's what it does. So you see this is a condensate receiving tank, okay, and it sends that condensate. Now condensate is steam that has turned back to water, right? You have to send it back to the feed water that goes into the boiler. So it's a circular process. So what are the pros and cons of a boiler? What are the pros and cons of a steam system? Okay. It has high heat content, okay? High transfer rates, okay? It can carry high amount of heat to wherever you want to take it to, as long as you do your insulation very well, okay? And minimize heat loss. Then sterile, of course, when you heat water, it becomes steam. If there are impurities, it doesn't go along. It remains in the process where the combustion has taken place. And of course, there's no living organism that can survive in a steam. Okay, so it is sterile. So steam is flexible. Okay, you can move it around. Then what are the cons? The downside of it. Sorry, this is repeated. But what are the cons? It is capital intensive. You know, to get a boiler and a steam system, operation-wise is also expensive. It has high pressure. High pressure means danger, which is the reason why I say that the most common one in the industry are not high pressure, they're the low pressure one. Then there's water treatment that is required. You don't need to send anyhow water. You need to treat the water that you're sending into the boiler, or that it will cause damage and even increase your maintenance cost. Of course, high temperature means high loss. If you have an elevated temperature, what that means is that you're going to increase your losses along the line. And once your losses increase along the line, that is money that is being wasted. Okay, steam system efficiency. Now there's a whole lot of losses in the steam system, okay? Now steam used in processes is about 60%. Then the losses that goes along the steam system is about 40%. And how do they accumulate? You see the different losses. Condensate and flash steam is about 20%. Remember I talked about condensate. and flash steam as well. Flash steam is at the point where it's now returning back to water and stuff like that. Sometimes you need to just open up a valve and then release those kind of flash steam. It's not a very good quality steam that you want in the system. So steam generation at the point that this steam generation is almost at the point of the boiler system. Okay. Now distribution and utilization is about 5 to 7. So when you add up all of this, you get 40%. Now this is about condensate recovery. Remember I talked about condensate. You see this blue square here is the condensate. Then the red one is the steam itself. That is the kind of steam that you want. Then the yellow one is a vapor. Okay. So now this is the boiler. Okay. Water, you heat water at a high temperature, it turns to steam, and you have to distribute it. So along the lines, it's going through. Some of them condensate, some of them return back to water, which is this blue that you're seeing, and you need to take them out. And that's why you have steam trap. So this is a steam trap where you need to remove that water out from the system and all of that. This is also a steam trap. I think this is a reservoir that collects. So this is also a steam trap. I think this is the reservoir. Then you have to send that water back into the to boiler to be heated up and converted back to steam. So condensate recovery. The condensate water condenses up to 20% of the steam energy. Returning this energy to the feed water tank preheats the feed water and thus lowers additional for energy input. So this is how recovering the condensate actually saves energy. The condensate water does not need to undergo water treatment again. Remember I talked about the feed water for boilers. You need to treat it at a very high level. Otherwise, it's going to damage your system and you're spending a lot of money. So you need to treat your water very well. But the condensate that you recover, you don't need to treat it away because it's already treated. You send it back to the boiler system. So the condensate water does not contain total dissolved solid. Thus, it reduces boilers glow down. Flash steam contains condensate that should be recovered. I talked about flash steam the other time. You know, like I said, it's at the point, it's just somewhere in between the steam and condensate. Okay, that's when you have the flash steam, and you need to remove it from your system, from the boiler system. Every six degree centigrade increase in feed water temperature gives 1% saving in fuel. Okay, so for every heat that you're able to recover from your stack temperature or your stack your vent system. For every 6 degrees centigrade that you're able to recover from there, you save 1% in your fuel for your boiler. Now, I made mention of steam trap when I was talking about the steam system, okay? So steam trap are a type of automatic valve that filters out condensate, okay? That is condensed steam that has turned back to water, and non-condensable gases such as air without letting steam escape. So you have to remove those water, okay, from the steam system without letting the steam to escape. That's what steam trap does, okay? According to global studies, steam leakage through orifice can be as high as 10% of consumption, okay? So if you don't take care of your steam trap, sometimes there could be leakages in your steam trap, which will eventually lead to loss of steam, okay? So it needs proper maintenance. And again, while you're now evacuating the condensate, the steam trap is releasing the condensate. Sometimes there are also some part of steam that might also escape with the condensate and all of that. So it's very important that these things are recovered. So if you look at this, you see orifice diameter. Now this is the valve that opens and closes to allow the condensate to move out. So sometimes you might have orifice, like a tiny hole in it, and if it's not taken care of, you can be losing steam. So steam system improvement. So use high quality steam trap. If you don't use the high quality steam trap, then you can stand the risk of losing steam in the process. And establish a program for the regular systematic inspection, testing, and repair of steam traps. Repair condensate. Return condensate to feed water. I talked about this. Okay, now this is one and two, and this is the third one. Steam leakage, okay? Find and fix leaks immediately. So if you look at it, this is a picture from an industry, and you're going to see leakage there. And I have a note there that this is flash steam, okay? This is a flash steam. If you can see it, it is no longer steam. You don't see steam, okay? But if you can see it, it is no longer steam. But what you're seeing there is, when you expose a high pressure steam to a low pressure environment, it's quickly condensed. That's what is happening there, okay? That's why you can see it to some extent. So it's turning from steam and about returning to condensate or returning to water. So that's what you're seeing there. So whenever there is a leakage, this is what happens. So you need to find it and fix it immediately. Then steam line installation, you need to insulate all your steam line processes. So this is a before picture and this is after picture. You can find out that this is not properly maintained. There are exposed surfaces. And if steam is moving through this, then you have a high heat loss. And then when you have high heat loss, you have frequent high level of condensate. And that's a lot of waste for any business. So steam line installation continues. So if, as an energy auditor, when you want to audit a steam line system, there's what's called thermal image camera, okay? It's an infrared camera. When you point that camera in a hot surfaces, the surface becomes red. So if you look at this image here, you find out that the red portion, this red portion means that there's no adequate insulation. You know, it's hot. And from this point, you can be losing substantial amount of heat. So what do you need to do? You need to identify them and then insulate them. So the picture below is where it's now been insulated. Okay, when Jinashi talked about energy auditing tools, he mentioned this thermal image camera. So you use it for this kind of purpose. So now I'm going to talk about heat exchanger. I've talked about it before, but this is now a section for heat exchanger. So heat exchangers are used at various points in steam system to extract heat from the carrier. You know, the carrier is steam, right? So you need to extract that heat. And when you extract that heat, what then happens? In many cases, it becomes a condensate, and you need to return that condensate. So it's a system, it's a circular system. So heat exchangers are used to extract heat or deposit heat, depending on the configuration that you have. So let us look at the image on the right. So you have steam that is coming into this heat exchanger. Then you have yogurt, okay, that needs to be heated. Yogurt is a counter current flow. When I say counter current, it means that moving in opposite direction. So steam is coming from this direction, and the yogurt that needs to be heated is coming from this direction. It extracts the heat from the steam, and this steam now turns to condensate. Okay. Now the yogurt is heated, the yogurt is hot. Now, if you want to cool that yogurt, okay, you pass it through this another heat exchanger. But in this case of heat exchanger, a cool air or a cold water is now coming in from here, okay, to strap that heat off the yogurt, okay? And the yogurt comes out here cold. Why this cold air or cold water comes out here being hotter, okay? So this is what you use heat exchangers to do. The same thing is happening in this case now, where you have a steam that is coming, and this is the heat exchanger here, okay? And it passes through the heat exchanger. By the time this water that is coming from here strap the heat from the steam returns to water, it returns to the condensate and is being extracted. The same process continues in this in the third image. So this is a typical heat exchanger for a recuperator. You know, if you want to, okay, it's written here, recuperator heat exchanger. Now this vertical axis is the stack gas or the vent gas, this vertical one, and this horizontal one is air that you want to use to extract the heat coming in from here. So if you notice, it is hot here, but by the time it's coming out from the top here, it's now cold. Why this one is cold? Well, by the time it's coming out here, it is now warm, not as hot as it is here. So that's what you use heat exchangers to do. Okay. For the economizer, in this case, in the case of air, you have water. That's for economizer, but for recuperators, you use air as your heat exchange medium. So heat exchange recovery. So common sources of heat, you have to identify where the heat are before you now begin to plan how you can recover them using heat exchanger. So common sources of this heat are compressor, flue gas, water, maybe condensate and all of that, oil cooler for power generation and so many other applications, jacket cooling and furnaces. So all of these are sources of heat. The common uses, what do you do when you recover this heat? What do you do with them? You use it to preheating, you use it for drying, you use it for sanitizing hot water, you use it for absorption chillers, and you use it for heat pump as well. We'll get to some of this equipment soon. Then this check heat for heat recovery. Please, you can just read up this mess. They're not too difficult to understand. But if you have any challenge, please do wait to reach out to me and I will explain them. So that's what called pinch analysis. Remember I said that in industrial processes, it's basically about addition and subtraction of heat. So when you're adding heat, you're heating. When you're removing heat, you're cooling, okay? So what about if there are processes that requires addition of heat and there are some of them that requires removal of heat, okay? You need to identify these two processes. So as you're removing heat from a certain process, instead of throwing that heat away, you're now using it to heat up the process that needs the heat. That's what pinch analysis is all about, okay? So you need heat here, you need cooling here. So when you extract the heat from the cooling processes, you don't throw it away, you don't release it to the environment. Find a way to use it to fulfill your heating need at the other end. So if you can bring these two processes together, that's fine. And that's what pinch analysis is all about. So I'm going to talk about heat pump. So heat pump is also a way for you to harness your waste heat, okay? The beauty about heat pump is that you can use it to improve the quality of your heat. So you can get a low grade heat and a heat pump can help you convert it to a high grade heat. Okay, that's the good thing about heat pump. Now, heat pump is the opposite of your air conditioning system. Remember, your air conditioning system absorbs heat from your room and it dumps that heat outside, right? But heat pumps collect that heat from outside and then use it to heat water for you. It dumps that heat inside the water or inside the air, depending on what you want it, what to use it for. So that's what heat pump does, okay? So if you look at the title, you're going to see heat pump. I'm trying to see the heading. So you have chillers, heat pump, and dryers. Okay, that's it. Heat pump does. Pump does a lot of things, okay? It does multiple things. It can be cooling and heating at the same time. That's the beauty of heat pump. Okay, so if you look at this system that I have here, okay? Now, at this point, it's extracting heat, okay? So at this point, it is giving out heat. So you can use it for cooling at this other end, and then use it for heating at this other end. Remember when I talk about the pinch analysis? You want to extract heat from a certain process, but you need that heat in another process. Heat pump helps you to achieve that perfectly, okay? And like I said, it's the opposite of your air conditioning system. We're going to look at a cooling system where we'll now discuss more about the operational procedures. So heat pump is measured in with a term known as coefficient of performance, COP, okay? That's how you measure the efficiency of a heat pump. Okay, now heat pumps actually has positive efficiency, like over 100. So it collects heat from the environment plus the heat from the electricity, assuming that your power is powered by electricity. It collects heat from the environment plus the heat of the electricity that you've given to it, and it gives you a higher value, a higher quantity of heat. So it usually have positive COP, maybe in the range of 34 or even 5, okay? So how you calculate the COP of heat pump is you look at the useful heat that it gives to you, then you now divide it by the electricity. You now divide it by the electricity that you use, that you get to it to be able to give you that heat, okay? So like I said, the same thing goes for all efficiency system. You're looking at the output over input. So useful heat energy added, all over energy consumption. It's just as simple as that. So energy efficiency of refrigeration systems and heat pump is denoted by its coefficient of performance, COP. There's another term we'll get to learn about. So a high COP value represents a high efficiency. So if you have a COP of 4, and you have another system that have a COP of 3, COP of 4 represents a high efficiency. That's what this means. Then COP is affected by evaporator temperature and condenser temperature. Okay. Now, if you're running your air conditioning system, you must have noticed that during cold weather days, your air conditioner appears to be working better. It appears to be cooling more than hot weather days. Now, the system that you have outside of your air conditioning system is the condenser, okay? So when the temperature is cool, it works better, right? So then the one you have inside your house is evaporator, okay? If you give it a very low, if you set the temperature to be very low, you in most cases you overwork it and you might not even achieve that your desired temperature. So for example, if you're running your air conditioning system and you set the temperature at 15 degrees centigrade or 16 degrees centigrade in Nigeria, not in Europe, not in America, in Nigeria, most likely you're not going to achieve 16 degrees centigrade. Because the more you try, the more the air conditioning system tries to go down to that 16 degrees centigrade, the more you have heat losses within your building walls, within your windows and everywhere. And it appears like you're just hitting the environment. You're most likely never going to get to that 16 degrees centigrade unless you now begin to insulate your walls and begin to implement high energy efficiency measures, or you begin to oversize the equipment, then perhaps you might get to that. So that's what this paragraph is trying to talk about, that your COP is affected by the evaporator temperature and the condenser temperature. This same thing I just explained. Higher the evaporator temperature, the lower the and lower the condenser temperature, better the COP. This is just what I explained. Perhaps when you read it at your own time, you understand it better. So here is saying that one degree centigrade higher temperature of refrigerants in the evaporator or 1 degree centigrade lower in the condenser improves the COP by 2% to 4%. So if you're running your air conditioning system, instead of putting it at 16 degrees centigrade, why not put it at 24 degrees centigrade? You save a lot of energy. That's what it's saying. You don't need to put it, the temperature difference doesn't have to be so much. If it becomes so much, you're going to be having a lot of losses, okay? So don't allow the temperature difference to be so much. Give it a closer, if the weather is 30 degrees centigrade, for example, and you want to cool down to 16 degrees centigrade, that would be hard. But if you decide to cool at 24 or 25, it's a lot easier to achieve, okay? That's what this is just simply saying. So performance measures. So energy performance ratio. Now, this is another way of checking the efficiency of heat pumps and air conditioning system. Remember, I told you that heat pump is opposite of air conditioning system. It does the opposite of air conditioning system. So they have similar way of assessing their efficiency, but a particular performance measure is well suited for one of the systems. So for example, you have energy efficiency ratio. Energy efficiency ratio is more suited for air conditioning system. Why the COP is more suited for the heat pump? So I talked about how you calculate your COP when I talked about the useful heat over the electricity. Now, this is the formula for calculating the energy efficiency ratio. Now you're calculating the kilojoule cooling output. That is the cooling output from your air conditioning system divided by the watt hour, that is energy that it's consumed, okay? So this is now in the form of energy ratio. You can also do it in form of power ratio. So you're looking at the power, the heat that the air conditioning system is able to extract out of your space, out of your living room. You have to quantify it in power, okay? Then you have to then divide it by the electric power that it's used to achieve that. That's what the power ratio of energy efficiency ratio is. It is expressed in power. Remember, we discussed about the difference between energy and power in our first class. So your energy efficiency ratio in power, energy efficiency ratio in power form is expressed in power. Why the energy form is expressed in energy? That's just the difference. Okay, so here is the conversion. If you're given the COP of a heat pump, but perhaps maybe you want to, you desire it to be in energy efficiency ratio. Here is a conversion formula to do that. The simplest way is to is 3.6 over energy efficiency ratio is equals to 1 over COP. Okay, so just you can just keep this formula in mind. Whenever you see such a problem, just call it up and then you do it. It's simple. So here is an example. Find the energy efficiency ratio of a heat pump having a COP of 4. Now you are given this COP, but you want it in energy efficiency ratio. So you just input the values in the formula and you have your energy efficiency ratio as 14.4. Energy efficiency ratio versus heat pump. I said this earlier that the energy efficiency ratio is more suitable for cooling system. Why the heat pump? Coefficient of performance, COP, is most suited for the, did I get this right? I said the energy efficiency ratio is for air conditioning system. Why the coefficient of performance is for your heat pump? I don't know if I said heat pump in the first place, but it's pretty clear. You will understand this when you read it. Let me just move ahead. At this point, I think we might just need to take a 10-minute break. Otherwise, it's subject to the house. If you approve, we take a 10-minute break. If not, we'll continue. What do you say?
I think taking a break is good, in my opinion.
Okay, so let us take a 10-minute break. So we will return at 3:43. We'll return at 3:43, please.
Okay.
10-minute break.